Thank you. Please be seated. St. Andrew's is a faith community of people gathered by God from across the national capital area to be a witness of Christian hope at the center of the region. Today, we worship on the traditional and unceded lands of the Algonquin people. And then our call to community and worship. The psalmist expresses his sheer joy and says, "I was delighted when they invited me to worship. We had reached the steep incline that led to the city of peace, the city we call Jerusalem. People poured in from every direction, expressing their awe, their joy, their gratitude to the one who is beyond naming. Today, we join this great procession through the ages, expressing our praise and gratitude to the one who gave us life and meaning to our existence. Together with God's people, we express our deepest desire for peace in our world, peace within our faith community, and peace within our families. Let us pray for God's Spirit to empower each one of us to become a peacemaker. Let us worship God. Let us pray. Ever-moving God, you always journey forward, inviting us to leave our status quo places, the places we feel safe and comfortable, but the places which often enslave us and prevent us from being all you intend us to be. You call us to venture forth into an unknown future, and the transformative experience of being genuinely refreshed and made new. We confess we often attempt to make you stationary, but you journey with us into the unknown future as a companion, a guide, and support. You seek to stretch our understandings and broaden our responses, especially when we insist there is one true belief and one right approach. Help us to realize the wilderness is a valued place we pass through, from which we gain insight, character, and inner strength, even though for us it can represent life situations we fear and try to avoid. Forgive our lack of trust, our lack of adventure, and our fearfulness. Challenge us to use our talents in your service to become agents of peace and reconciliation." Let us pray together the prayer Jesus taught his disciples. "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Friends, God loves us into love, so we can both receive and give. God cares even when we don't experience that care, for God understands, values, and even cherishes us regardless what we have done or have failed to do. Know we are accepted, loved, and forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Good morning and welcome, everyone. Bon matin et bienvenue à tous. My name is Althea Williams Goodman. It is my pleasure to welcome you as we gather today in person and online. Mon nom est Althea Williams Goodman. J'ai le plaisir de vous accueillir alors que nous nous réunissons aujourd'hui en personne et en ligne. A special welcome to those of you who are visiting us for the first time. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I will draw your attention to a few of the announcements that are in your bulletin. Please consider this a personal invitation to participate in the activities that are outlined. You're invited to enjoy social time and refreshments in Grand Hall, which are through the south doors, immediately after the service. The countdown is on for Vacation Bible School. So the event will be taking place from August 15th to the 19th. There is a need for volunteers to supervise the children while they wait to be picked up. So the time that we need volunteers for is 3 to 5 p.m. Please contact Heather Payton if you can help out for one afternoon or more. The annual Gracefield Retreat will be taking place from September 9th to 11th. You may attend for the full weekend or just one day if that works best for you. Registration forms are also in Grand Hall. And lastly, a big thank you to Elizabeth Phillipson for working on the church gardens this summer. It's there for all of us to enjoy along with passersby. These are the announcements. We turn now to today's responsive psalm, Psalm 139, 1 to 12. We read from the slim red book in the book rack on the back of the pew in front of you. We will begin by singing the first refrain, then I will read, and then together we'll read the bolded text. So that's Psalm 139, 1 to 12, and we will be singing the first refrain. You have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. Oh, you hem me in behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain it.
I praise you, for I am wonderfully made.
Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I descend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light around me become night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day. For darkness is as light to you.
Children to come if we have children with us. Oh, that's great, because I need some help this morning. If you kind of stand facing this way, okay, facing the people. Okay. We're going to sing a song, and the song says, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And I'd like you to do some actions, and I have some actions for them, but I don't want you to stay with my actions. Maybe you think of some actions that work. And so the actions I have is when we sing, Jesus, 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 I hold up my hand. And then it says, Jesus in the morning, and the morning is early. So then I do this. And then we have Jesus at noontime, which is the middle. And then Jesus when the sun comes down, and I make this motion. So you think you can do that as well? But do your own. If you like to do it a little differently, that's great. Okay? So we'll have the song. I didn't expect Presbyterians would do the motions. So what did you do this morning?
I woke up.
Right. Yes. You woke up. Okay, that's good. What did you do this morning? You woke up too, right? What else did you do? You ate your breakfast. What did you do after you ate your breakfast? You got ready for church. Great. Anybody brush their teeth after breakfast? So there's so many things we do each day, don't we? And I want to mention one thing that some people do before they go to sleep at night. and they pray. And so this morning, I want to teach you a prayer. And it's very simple. The prayer is, thank you. Can you say that? Thank you. So, just before you go to sleep, think of the things you are thankful for. So, it may be you're thankful for your mother, or you're thankful for a friend that you met, or maybe you had an exciting time at some camp or someplace. Think of what you are thankful for, and then pray, thank you. Thank you, God. And I want to say that that's a beautiful, wonderful habit to have. Before you go to sleep at night, just that simple prayer, thank you. So let us pray together. Say after me, thank you, God. Amen. Have a great time if you go to Sunday school, right? There you go. So nice to see you, hey? Oh, you're four. Wow. Wow. As we prepare for the reading of Scripture, let us pray. God of wisdom, by the leading of your Spirit, open our minds to receive new insights from familiar stories. Open our hearts to grasp deeper truth revealed through the Scriptures, and especially through Jesus Christ, your living Word. Let the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you. Amen.
Good morning. Bonjour. Today's first reading is from Amos, verses 1 to 12. This is what the Lord God showed me, a basket of summer fruit. He said, Amos, what do you see? I said, a basket of summer fruit. The Lord said to me, the end has come upon my people, Israel. I will never again pass them by. The songs of the temple shall become wailings on that day. The dead bodies shall be many and cast out in every place. Be silent. Hear this, you who trample on the needy, you who trample on the needy and bring ruin to the poor of the land, saying, when will the new moon be over so we may sell grain, and the Sabbath so we may offer wheat for sale? We will make the epath small and the shekel great. We will practice deceit with false balances, buying the poor for silver, the needy for a pair of sandals, and selling the sweeping of the wheat. The Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, surely I will never forget any of their deeds. Shall not the land tremble on this account, and everyone mourn who lives in it, and all of it rise like the Nile, be tossed about and sink again? On that day, says the Lord God, I will make the sun go down at noon and darken the earth in broad daylight. I will turn your feasts into mourning and all your songs into lamentation. I will bring sackcloth on the lions and baldness on every head. I will make it in the morning for only sun and the end of it like a bitter day. The time is surely coming, said the Lord God, when I will send a famine on the land, not a famine of bread or a thirst for water, but hearing the words of the Lord. They shall wander from sea to sea and from north to east. They shall run to and fro, seeking the word of the Lord, but they shall not find it. Second reading is from Colossians 1, 15 to 28. Christ is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. In Christ, all things, and in heaven, on and earth, were created, things visible and invisible, whether thrones, dominions, rulers, or powers. All things have been created for him and by him, through him and for him. Christ is therefore all things. In Christ, all things hold together. Christ is the head of the body, the church. Christ is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so he might come to have first place in everything. For in Christ, all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through Christ, God was pleased to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross. You who were once estranged and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, Christ has now reconciled in his fleshy body through death, so as to present you holy and blameless and irreproachable before him, provided you continue securely established and steadfast in the faith, without shifting from the hope promised by the gospel you heard, which has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven. I, Paul, become a servant of this gospel. I am now rejoicing in my sufferings for your sake and in my flesh. I am completing what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, the church. I become its servant according to God's commissioner, which was given to me for you, to make the world of God fully known, the mystery hidden throughout the ages and generations, but has now been revealed to his saints. To them, God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. It is he whom we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone in all wisdom, so we may present everyone mature in Christ. The last reading today is Luke 10, 38 to 42. Jesus entered a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him in her home. She had a sister named Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks, so she came to him and asked, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her to help me." The Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her."
Thank you.
I'd like to think that we are part of a story that began a long, long time before we arrived on the scene, and a story that will continue long after we are gone. I'd like to think of this as a drama that is unfolding. Each of us is either given or we choose the script in this drama. Either we choose the role that we take in life, or we take on the role that society assigns us. And this morning I was talking with a person, and we mentioned the word vocation. So you can also look at this as a vocation. Each one of us is assigned a vocation, or we choose a vocation. And so there's the gospel passage of that features Martha. And I take it that Martha is taking the assigned role. I'm not sure if she chose that role, because there is some annoyance there. There is some annoyance there. And then there is Jesus, who responds to her and says, Mary has chosen the better role. And I want to look at this a little bit deeper and say that Mary sat down and listened to the teacher. And I wonder if that was what usually happened when a teacher came. I have this sense that in the culture in which she lived, it would be only men that would be invited to listen to the teacher. Women took a second place. And so what you have is there, you have an assertiveness on the part of Mary to take a role, to take a role that society wasn't really giving to her. And it reminds me of when I first began my ministry in the Presbyterian Church. It was still at a time when there was a real debate about whether women could be elders and whether women could be ministers. And some of the first women ministers in the Presbyterian Church had to kind of, you know, take a pretty strong stand and say, we too have a place in this community. So I think that is kind of interesting that Jesus kind of affirms Mary's choice to be true to herself. And it makes me think of a passage where the gospel writer has Jesus say, come to me, all who are weary, and take my yoke. And I translate it to say, take my yoke because it fits. It fits. And that doesn't mean that we all become the person of Jesus. It means to be true to who God calls us to be. So we choose the script, we choose our vocation because it doesn't chafe. It doesn't chafe. So that brings me to, I've been kind of wrestling with this, a little bit struggling with this, because we have the story of Jesus of Nazareth. And we have the Gospels that tell what Jesus did, the healings that he did, and the teachings that he did. And everything we read in the Gospels has been read by people throughout the world, whether they are Christians, whether they are Muslims, whatever people in the world have read the stories about Jesus in the Gospels. And they have read the kind of person that Jesus was. And by and large, there is a deep admiration and a deep respect for what I would say is Jesus of Nazareth. But then we come to the part of the role that Jesus took in life, but we go beyond that because the early church and the church throughout the last 2,000 years has assigned a role to Jesus. And they use the term Christ. And that is the role that the church over the ages has assigned to Jesus. So Jesus of Nazareth becomes the Christ of the followers of Jesus, what they believe Jesus came to do. And so I want to kind of work with this and try to kind of indicate of how one might read that. And then I would contrast the word sign and the word symbol. A sign usually has one meaning. When you travel and you come to the light and the light turns red, you know there's only one meaning. Stop. That's a sign. We can have a discussion over it, but it has only one meaning. Stop. But when we have a symbol, then the meaning of the symbol is what the community puts into it. It's what the community puts into it. So when we have the symbol of the word Christ, the meaning of it is the meaning that the Christian community has put in it over the years. And the interesting thing is that over time, this meaning evolves, and it doesn't necessarily stay the same. And so, what tragically, from my perspective, has happened, that throughout the history of the church, there have been so many debates and fights and arguments over the meaning and understanding of the symbol of Christ. And so the church has been very, whatever church you are with, whatever perception you have, by and large, the church has been very defensive, always defending their particular meaning. And I kind of think, is there a better way? Is there a better way to move forward? And so we have the Colossian passage, and I'm sure that many, many interpretations have been given to it. Many people have wrestled with the passage. But what if we simply took that passage and said, this is where the Apostle Paul expresses his enthusiasm and his convictions and what he believes about Christ, and he shares it with us. No debate is necessary. We simply say, this is the words that the Apostle Paul left with us. What does one do when one experiences something that has that deep sense within you, that deep sense of conviction? What does one do? There's a story about the person who took a trip to explore the Amazon River. And he spent a couple weeks going through the river. I don't know if he went with canoe or whatever, and he explored. And he was so enthusiastic. When he came back, he wanted to encourage everybody to have the experience that he had. And what the people did is they asked him to draw a map. To draw a map of the Amazon River and what he saw. And then they took hold of that map and they put it on the wall. And sometimes I think this is a little bit about the Christian faith. We have people share their experiences and then we capture it and then we put it on the wall. What we need to encourage is that we experience it ourselves so that we can come and say, this is what this symbol means to me. This is what Christ means to me. I also wanted to read a poem for you and then say the poem has always struck me, and it's one by George Herbert. And it's titled The Pulley. And why he calls it The Pulley, I have no idea. It's a short poem. It says, when God at first made human beings, having a glass of blessings standing by, let us, said he, pour on him all we can. Let the world's riches, which dispersed lie, contract into a span. So strength first made a way, then beauty flowed, then wisdom, honor, pleasure. When almost all was out, God made a stay. Perceiving that alone of all his treasure, rest in the bottom lay. For if I should, said he, bestow this jewel also on my creation, he would adore my gifts instead of me, and rest in nature, not in the God of nature. So both should losers be. Yet let him keep the rest, but keep them with repining restlessness. Let him be rich and weary, that at least, if goodness lead him not, yet weariness may toss him to my breast. And so, if I go back to Jesus of Nazareth, and I go back to the Gospels, then I believe what comes through many times is that Jesus, in his own way, is expressing a vision. and expressing a vision of what he believes God has in mind for the world. And so we can look at many passages. We can look at the passage in Matthew 25, what you did for the least of these. We can look at the actions of Jesus that he never used violence. There's so many different things that we can look at the life of Jesus and the way he lived it and what he taught and say, this gives us a picture. So we begin then to ask ourselves, what is God's vision for the world? And I just want to mention one that comes to me because there are so many fights in the world. And it comes to me from Psalm 24, I believe, the first verse. It says, the earth belongs to the Lord. So I asked myself, what vision does God have for the world? And I'm sure, it's my conviction, that God would not create borders. God would not create borders. That's not how he envisioned the world to be. So that's, if we had a sharing, that would be my contribution, my conviction that the borders we have drawn up in the world have created so much problems. We have Ukrainians now being slaughtered. Why? Because a border. Think of all the people that have died over the last 100 years because of borders. Borders that we have to defend because we have to defend ourselves against those who are our enemies. I would say that's not the vision that Jesus had for the world. It's not the vision of the prophets. And I don't believe it's the vision of God. So when I read the poem that God poured all these things, I think that together we could, in a multi-faith setting, we could share what we believe is God's vision for the world. And not argue and say, well, this person is totally off base. This person is wrong. But let's just share our vision, knowing that our vision is not the final word. Knowing that our perception of God's vision for the world is not the final word. But we put it on the table and then we begin to say, how do we respond in life? How do we respond when we hear different people express the vision and that some of it, many times, we can resonate to it and say, yes, I agree. Regardless whether you're a Muslim or whether you are part of the Jewish faith, it doesn't matter what faith you are, I agree with you that with this particular vision that you have. And for us as Christians, we have the benefit of having the story of Jesus, the story of what Jesus taught his disciples, and also we have the example of how Jesus lived. So let's go out into the world and pour these convictions and these ideas, not to argue or debate, but simply to share with each other. We are now going to have ministry and music. Let us pray. Loving God, we come to you trusting your power works in the world in ways we cannot even imagine, calling goodness forward, supporting love, creating justice even in situations which seems hopeless to us. Thank you for your spirit at work in our lives. As your heart is open to us, open our hearts to you. God, you who care for the world and all its people, we pray for those who lift up their voices in troubled nations, for those working to bring justice, for those who negotiate peace, for those bringing aid to the vulnerable, and those offering shelter to anyone fleeing violence. God of justice and compassion, call the powerful to account. Challenge them to hear the voices which cry out in pain and desperation. God, present in our everyday lives, we pray for our community, our neighbors, whose everyday lives have been disrupted by months of pandemic restriction, by economic realities often beyond their control. We remember neighbors whose livelihoods depend on dependable weather systems, those fearing fire, flood, or drought this summer. We pray for communities lacking safe drinking water or adequate medical care, and places where there's high unemployment or a worker shortage. God of the courageous and compassionate, challenge and inspire leaders to combine compassion with good planning, to consider the needs of all who feel desperate, Encourage those who live out their commitments to the well-being of others day by day in public service, healthcare, education, social work, community organizations, and environmental concerns. Thank you for their dedication. God of neighborhood and nation, support those who feel stress or exhaustion. Inspire those who speak out when they see needs being neglected. We pray for friends and neighbors near and far, for all who travel, for those who find themselves strangers in new communities. We remember in silence those on our hearts facing some kind of challenge this day. Thank you, God, for hearing both our spoken and unspoken prayers. Amen. And as we prepare for the offering, let us pray. The stories of Scripture remind us there are many ways to give in gratitude for God's goodness to us. Whatever we have to give, let us give joyfully, generously, trusting God to do more than we can ask or imagine. Living, loving God, Martha offered the work of her hands to Jesus. Mary offered her close attention. We bring the gifts we have to offer. Bless and multiply them. Show us how they can best serve your purposes in our church and in your world. In the name of Christ, our living Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
Friends, be who you are meant to be. Astonish the world with your acts of kindness. Allow humor to lighten the burden of your tender heart. In a society dark with cruelty, let the people hear the grandeur of God in the peals of your laughter. Let your eloquence elevate the people to heights they had only imagined. Experience and share the blessing of the God of Abraham and Sarah, of Jesus Christ, the son of our sister Mary, and of God's Spirit who broods over us as a mother hen broods over her chicks.
Thank you.